Oh, your boy's back at it again. Internet. It's Brethren Around. I'm your host, Wes Gardner, commie to hobo himself. And over there, that sexy luchador, Mr. Marco
three time internet.
Three time internet. That's right. That's Marco Flores, yeah, Nerd man. The Bay. How are you, sir?
I'm doing okay. Next week I'm gone.
I know it, man. Like, this is
crazy. I'll be on the other side of the world.
That's wild. So, explain a little bit about your trip, about your goings on.
So, yeah, this was kind of abrupt. We weren't even planning on going. So we're going to the Philippines. Me, my wife, and my family.
Yeah.
My family was kind enough to buy our plane tickets. So I was like, yeah, we'll go on a free trip. Sure. we're gonna go to the Philippines. We're gonna be there for like 3 weeks. So unfortunately, I will not be here at the podcast. But I did hear from Kami that there's gonna be some special things in the works. Mm. In that meantime,
yeah, a little bit.
A little bit of something, you know, maybe call up some old friends or whatever, or do something random that you never catch you by surprise, like an RKO, pretty much.
Yeah, RKO out of nowhere. Like we could talk to some old friends, or we could bring back an old friend. You know what I'm saying? A little regularly diet fans from a year or so ago. Maybe had a daily dose of something that maybe they might be, their diet might be a little missing out on. They don't got that vitamin C. You know what I mean? They might have a little bit of deficiency.
A vitamin K.
Yeah, a little vitamin K, maybe. Interesting.
Yeah. So, I'll be gone for those 3 weeks, but I doubt I'll be able to come back on, but like I think I'm just going to take these 3 weeks just to disconnect.
Oh yeah, man.
Just totally disconnect and just enjoy life and you know, take pictures of all my food because that's what you do on Instagram and whatever that I come across in the Philippines, like mooses and
the wild native moose.
Yeah, you know, bamboo sticks and all that stuff. I'm just gonna enjoy with being with the family. So
yeah, man, it's good to disconnect. And speaking of,
yeah,
that was my basically past 3 days going on work related retreat. Out to really, it used to be an ostrich farm. Like they repurposed an ostrich farm, and
oh wow,
yeah, there were like buffalo just like hanging out. Mm-hmm. Like they really took us to the Twilight Zone, I think. Like we got there, you're hanging out with buffalo, you're hanging out with, like, there was a zebra. I was like, why is there a zebra here? Like, this is middle of Texas, like, what's going on? And then for this place used to be an ostrich farm, right? There was one ostrich. Mm-hmm. And I was like, did he eat all the other ones? Like, did he
that's
win
the golden chocobo?
He won. That's the winner.
Yeah, that's the golden chocobo.
He's the number one guy. it was a work-related retreat, and they give you tons of food. Just, you're never not without food. It's like going over to grandma's house, and she's like, well, have you eaten? It's like, yeah, grandma, I've eaten. I made 4 pot roasts. Why did you make that much food? Like, why? It's just me, and like, maybe, you know, I mean, overall, there was like 20 people throughout the whole thing, facilitators and moderators and all this other stuff. But There was enough food to feed 5,000 people, and it was it was everywhere. It was like pot roast, and then it's like, oh, big barbecue baked potatoes. And you're like, oh, Jesus. And like they had a gym. Yeah, they had a gym there. And the gym
was there anybody?
Yeah, the gym was all 1971, like that weird turquoise green color that all the Impalas used to be. You know what I mean? Like that weird minty green. All these machines that haven't been used in 5 years, and I was the one in there, and all the squeaky, rusty, you know.
Oh, dude.
Working out all that stuff.
I feel like if you saw what the gym looked like, and then you had the clothes for it, like I would have cosplayed like 1970s or 80s Muscle Beach gear, like the short shorts and like super tight tank top and like the headband or whatever.
Lou Ferrigno.
All that. Just do it. Do all of that.
You pull out a Franco Colombo, like you're doing there, and you're absolutely. Yeah. And then just flexing at everybody for no reason, and they're like, "What's this guy doing?"
Yeah,
this is a work retreat. What is he doing?
Sure, man.
Like he's eating pot roast out of a bucket, and he's like posing with all this old crappy gym equipment.
Yeah,
but it was great, like to unwind and stuff, like because you know me, and we're both kind of the same. We're always tied into everything. Like we're getting tweets, we're getting Facebook this and email that, and oh, check the settings on this, and we're going to record that, and we're going to plan out this. But, like, this was 3 days of nothing, and it was kind of great because it was taught, but the whole thing was kind of the main moderator was this old guy who invented the whole retreat anyway, and he's been all around the world and doing this stuff, and he was 82 years old.
And he's still doing it.
Still doing it, man. And he was like, no one can do it like I can, so I'm here. Like, let's do this.
Yeah.
And I'm like, hell yes, this guy's awesome. But it was like learning from Yoda. Like I said it before the show, but here's this old wise sensei that was like basically whipping you with a cane, being like, you're thinking about things wrong, you idiot. Like, get out of it. Like, shake yourself up.
You stupid idiot.
But it was great. Like, he wasn't that aggressive about it. But like he would say things like, you know, whenever you go to a work related conference or something, normally you get there and you check into your room, and then they're going to give you the itinerary. You know, this starts at here, and the main lobby conference starts at 9 a.m. and the keynote speaker is going to be so and so, and like they have all this just bullshit, right? Just lined up, and here we showed up. And all the chairs were in a circle. And then, so we get there, and he was like, so how was the bus ride here? You know, because we all took a bus. And, you know, I knew a few people on the bus. I was, hey, how you doing? One of my coworkers, like, that I work with in my department. I was like, great, yeah, you know, great. I like meeting people, sure. We're like, no, it was good. It was okay. It was good. He was like, I guarantee you the bus ride home is going to be much more rowdy, because you're going to know everybody like a best friend.
Yeah.
And then we're like, what did we get ourselves into? Like, what? You get there and it's almost like Fight Club. You're like, what did we just walk into?
Right.
And then throughout the whole 3 days, it's stuff like one of his main rules, and it blew my mind, is he was like, I don't want you taking notes. He's like, if you have something to write with, I want you to throw it away. Like, no, we're talking.
That's awesome.
We're going to sit and talk to human beings. I don't want you on your phone. Yeah. I don't want you writing down a thing. I'm not going to hand you a pamphlet that you sift through to act like you're interested. Like, no, we're not. We're just talking to human beings. That's all we're doing for 3 days. And then it was great because he ended it. Like, he showed a copy of the itinerary. So he handed one out and it's all empty. Like, it's a blank calendar. And he was like,
oh, wow.
Yeah. He was like, we have nothing planned. So that means we're going to get a lot done. I was like, oh, shit. Like, he was inside the Matrix, right? Like, he had this life thing figured out. And you just hear him talk, and then you end up talking with people around you and, like, getting this renewed energy from work and, like, what you're doing and what's your purpose there. And, like, but you're not talking about the job. You're talking about the people.
Yeah.
And I was like, man, why can't every conference be like this? Like, at first, we were all nervous and like, what is this? Yeah. What's this going to be? And then we leave and we're like, screw all this other stuff. Like, we need to do this every other week. Because that was great,
right?
You know? But we talked about, like, right before we hit record, we talked about there was so much food everywhere, right? It was just food. They have snacks, and they're handing you this, and then you go and you do a big old breakfast, and then, oh, here's a nacho bar, and here's all this. You're like, where are they getting all this food? And, like, I brought home, in my suitcase, like, 8 things. Like, I brought home... like all these snacks and chip packs and, you know, all these junk food. They just
you're like Ross, Friends, whenever they go on trips and like he just packs up the hotel.
Pretty much. That's what it felt like. And they were like, no, take it. Here, did you get enough? Did you get more? Like, do you need more? You're like, leave me alone. I have like 4 pounds of junk in my... It's crazy. But we talked about that, and we talked about... It was no, It was the polar opposite of a continental breakfast that you get at a hotel or a motel.
Continental breakfast.
To where you wake up and it's like, oh, they have bagels. Hmm. And then whenever they say bagel, they mean it's a roll that they cut in half and stuck a fork in the middle of.
They're actually bagels, not bagels.
Yeah, right. They're bagel bites, but they just scraped off the toppings.
Like, yeah. It's horrible.
Dude, there's been some bad. The worst at those continental breakfasts, the worst thing is whenever they have like the liquidy, flimsy bacon.
Oh,
and you're like, bro,
yeah.
Who did you try to fucking boil bacon? Like, what did you do to this?
Yeah,
you got to get crispy bacon. Like, that's that's a rule. Like, that's a rule posted somewhere for some reason. Like, crispy bacon. You accept no substitutes, right? Like
eggs, bacon, sausage if you have it.
What they call sausage. It's not even a real, like, it's a gray tube of something. You look at it and you're like, I don't know what this is.
It's like the bakers are feeding you. Resident Evil 7.
Oh, yeah, pretty much. It's like you get free continental breakfast and you get to take home two new pets. And they're roaches. You know, it's your.
Have you watched anything of Resident Evil 7?
So I did a little bit, and I own Resident Evil 7. I bought it the day it came
out.
Oh,
do you?
Have not had a single second to play it.
Oh, man.
Yeah.
I'm watching it, and like, oh, man, it's. Dude, I'm pretty sure. I'm pretty sure since Leonis said that it was his most disappointing game, I'm pretty sure he'll double back.
Dude, it looks intense.
Because I'm watching it. I'm not playing it. I'm just watching people like Let's Play and stuff. Dude, that's a really tense game, man. It's a really tense game. Like, you know how you would deal with zombies in like every hallway?
Mm-hmm.
So like when you deal with enemies, it's just it'll be like either one person or one enemy in like a room or a hallway. But like they'll chase you wherever you go, so you need to take them down or stun them enough to like run away. But like it's like I don't know, like when I'm seeing them fight the enemies, like the bullets are scarce, like more scarce than they are in other Resident Evil games. They may not be as effective, especially when you're fighting with any of the bakers. It's pretty intense. I'm really enjoying watching it right now. And I know, like I figure like if I were to get like my PS4 or whatever, I probably wouldn't get the game.
Okay.
I mean, I probably would. This probably would be the only type of horror game that I would get because I could deal with Resident Evil.
Yeah.
But anything else, like no way. Like no Outlast, no
right,
no PT or whatever. But yeah. Resident Evil 7, like I'm liking what I'm watching and it's
that's cool.
You'll really like it.
Yeah, it looks really tense whole chasing.
Yeah, definitely. Yeah. Yes. It is really intense, man.
And then apparently they have safe rooms that you can go in, but
safe rooms, yeah, that they cannot get into.
Right.
So like yeah.
Okay. Sort of. Yeah, like cuz I hear they kind of break that rule a few times. To where you think you're in a safe room, like whoops!
Oh yeah! Oh no, okay! Yeah, like, right! Boom! Yeah, they pop up and
terrifying,
yeah. Dude. Yeah,
they're making it in VR. Really like I would have a heart attack in VR.
Oh jeez, no! I cannot deal with VR. I cannot deal with that.
Like VR stuff anyway, just preliminary. Like if you go to Walmart and get one of those $20 headsets for your phone,
right, yeah,
that shit can scare you. Like,
yeah,
I can't imagine high fidelity, 1080 looking. You know, oh, this stuff looks pretty realistic. Type of VR, like I'd probably just vomit all the time because that's crazy. It's crazy to me. I'd love to try it. But I also don't want to, cause in order to do VR in the house, I would have to buy another graphics card. So there's $300. Then you'd have to buy the headset. So there's $800. You know, I mean, that's an investment.
Yeah.
But I'm glad that you know, they still stuck by their guns and still did a first person horror game, which they've never done really before. They've done some on rail shooter type things for Japanese arcades, but nothing like this. Yeah, this is more like Outlast, like you said, like more of a you control the duder, but shit just jumps out at you. And I mean, even Outlast got me because you don't, you just don't know what to expect. And I think it's interesting because even with Resident Evil, you know something's going to happen, but you don't know what it is and you don't know where it is.
Yeah.
And I think that adds to that, like, oh God, I'm going to look behind me. Oh, nothing there. And then I'm going to look behind me and nothing there. Oh God. Like you build this tension. And then if you know somebody's chasing after you, you're like, oh, that's just, that's on another level.
Dude. Yeah. Man, Resident Evil 7. I still need to watch. So I still need to watch the rest of it, but yeah, I'm really liking it.
Apparently it's only like watching it. 4 hours long, 4 to 5 hours.
Is it really
for the whole thing?
Oh, wow. I may not be that far then, I guess.
I think so.
Yeah, maybe. And then they're already doing a DLC for it. Ethan Must Die. So I think, like, I want to say in that DLC, like, every room there's like a booby trap and like one, it's one hit kills type of thing.
Oh, yeah.
So you like you'll get to, you get so good to a point where you're kind of like speed running through it. So that's pretty cool, man. That's pretty cool.
And I know, yeah,
whenever you can, man, delve into it.
Yeah, I definitely need to. Apparently, the ending, I don't want to give a lot away, but I have heard certain characters make appearances.
Okay.
Certain things happen that, because right now you're probably at a point to where like this is a cool looking game, but I don't know how this is Resident Evil. But
yeah,
the ending kind of takes care of that real quick.
Okay.
Yeah, you find out some revelations about stuff and that pun intended, I guess, with Resident Evil Revelations. But
I'm gonna throw it out there. Is Wesker the president?
Right. Right. you figure out that whole family was just Nemesis with different like clothes on.
He just
wears a wig. It's like, oh, it's me, Mama Baker. And you're like, whoa.
So I saw that whole dinner table. I'm like, okay, so these are the enemies. And I see the grandma to the left. And I'm like, fuck you, you're the boss. You're final boss right there.
Yeah.
I think you're the final boss.
Anytime. Dead,
barely alive grandma that's barely saying anything to you. Yes. Like, yeah, you're the boss.
Anytime there is old lady in any sort of horror anything, that's the ballgame. So perfect example of this. I think I was talking with Brittany about this like a week or two ago.
Mm-hmm.
The moment I saw the preview for that M. Night Shyamalan film, Devil.
Oh, okay. Yeah.
Like the one where they're stuck in the elevator, right?
Stuck in the elevator.
Like six or seven people stuck in the elevator. You got the whole, you know, it's a whole peanut gallery. Everybody's required for. You got the Asian character. You got the black character. You got everybody. You got every demographic represented, all of it.
Yeah.
The moment I saw that trailer, I was like, oh, it's the old woman. I promise you it's the old woman. That's the only one. Because, of course, an old granny, sweet old granny. No.
Yeah.
Fuck all that. It ain't sweet old granny at all. Like, I know it.
But you were spot on, though, right?
Yep.
Okay.
That's it. I mean, spoilers for Devil, but come on.
Spoiler, but like,
if you didn't think it was the granny, you're misguided. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Like, that's not really a spoiler. It's a spoiler about life. Like, it's always the granny.
You don't know the horror tech yet.
Yeah,
so.
you're not at the A-list tier on the horror knowledge. Like, it's always the old woman. Always.
Yeah.
It's like if there's a Scooby-Doo episode. Grandma. Hell, Scooby-Doo does it. If there's an old woman in the Scooby-Doo episode, it's her. Every time.
Oh, dude. Every single time. The Visit.
Oh,
that movie,
see?
Yeah.
Oh.
I mean, and but that's blatant, right? That's blatant. That, like, yeah, the old people are like, they're acting weird.
Oh, won't crazy! You get the oven? Crazy, okay. Grandpa.
Yeah.
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 It's a trope for a reason, man.
Yeah.
You know,
old people are scary.
That's right. Old people are scary. They've been around the block. They don't got time for your shit.
Mm-hmm.
Like, that's it. It's a ball game.
Yeah, man.
They don't got time for you whippersnappers.
So when we get to that part, that day and age, we're going to be scaring the shit out of the kids.
Oh, absolutely. We'll be with our Werther's Originals. We're going to be on the porch. We're going to tell really fucked up stories for no reason.
I'm literally going to do that baker gimmick. I'm just going to sit there and just be like dead-eyed when they're trying to check on me.
Somehow you
have, I got you, bitch.
Yeah. somehow you have a barbed wire baseball bat.
Yeah.
Like, who knows? Grandpa got it. I don't know.
Yeah, Grandpa Negan here.
He's wearing his luchador mask and he has a barbed wire baseball bat. I don't know.
Dude, did you see Lucha Underground gonna be on Netflix?
Netflix, dude. Yeah, man.
Yeah. Day after Valentine's Day. So happy Valentine's Day to you. Right?
to all of us out there in
to all of us. Nice you're gonna get to know who Dario is.
So is it? It's seasons 1 and 2, correct?
Seasons 1 and 2, correct? Because they're currently on season 3.
You gotcha.
And they're on mid break right now because they did like mid season finale type of thing.
Yeah.
But yeah, seasons 1 and 2. I'm pretty excited because I watched all of season 1 and then for whatever reason I skipped season 2 entirely. Then I got back on season 3, but like if you don't have El Rey, the El Rey network, it's pretty difficult to be able to watch it.
Yeah.
So this is so much easier just to be able to find those episodes and
get
just
on Netflix and
burn them through.
So I think season 2, I know a little bit about season 1 because, you know, we talked about Lucha Underground a little bit before and like we've seen matches and we've seen spots, but I never saw like the continuity part. So apparently, is it near the end of season 1 where shit just goes crazy? Like,
So season 1. Oh, okay. So I did talk about this before. So season 1. Okay, from season 1, it starts as like underground fighting tournament.
Yeah.
Any pick any kind of like fighting game that has that type of trope.
Sure.
Underground fighting tournament with the cookie, like underground promoter that's willing to pay so much money for all these violent fights.
Right.
And so like it continues on and then like all of a sudden it becomes like, is it all about these ancient Aztec tribes and like what? Why did it become like what's like Highlander type of thing? Like it became Highlander all of a sudden. And then like you finish season 1 and it becomes you finish season 1 and it starts season 2, then it becomes Twisted Metal, the game, because there's vehicles involved now. And then then it progresses, and then like I think right now season 3, it is becoming Mortal Kombat with people have said generally with the Infinity Gauntlet. I like to think of like if you ever watch like Fatal Fury, the motion picture with the whole Armor of Mars type of thing, collecting armor pieces. Yeah.
Right.
It's really
the fact that people Dragon Balls type stuff.
Yeah, you're collecting Dragon Balls, but this is armor and this there may or may not be soul transferring and I was pinpointing something. The fact that people quote unquote died. Because people do die off, you know, it's ridiculous, but like if you listen to like, or you read like backstage type of news, then you'll hear that character comes back as another person, but like you won't know because they're masked or something.
Oh, gotcha, right?
Yeah. So it's nuts,
and I
love it because it's that nutty.
Isn't one of the characters? Can't they in the backstage segments only? Of course, can't they like teleport or something like Nightcrawler style
okay. So one of them has powers. Yeah, they kind of could do this. They have the teleportation of like say Undertaker, that kind of thing. Lights go out, they disappear. Lights go out again, they're right behind the person type of thing. Yeah, they had that thing going, and then there's like a whole big storyline with that person. It's a girl. She may or may not be an ancient person or whatever.
Oh dear.
But like you find out more and more. Oh yeah, and then like as the seasons progress, you notice that each of the luchadors or the wrestlers or fighters, quote unquote, they have forms. Like season one, this particular wrestler has this type of costume.
Yeah.
Season two, they upgrade, like they power up, they get Super Saiyan 1, and like their costume like changes, and like it's more defined, and like yeah, season two and three, and yeah, they get more elaborate with their costumes. So like you'll notice from where you see them in season one to where they're at now, it's like you see progression and evolution, and it's all crazy. It's funny.
That's so awesome. I think all wrestling needs that type of stuff.
Yeah, totally, man.
Because we talked about like the Royal Rumble and all that stuff, and like mm-hmm. someone I forgot to mention who made a really big impact, but because it made me laugh, was Jack Gallagher. Because
Jack Gallagher
just comes out. He does some World of Sport style like handstands, and then they throw him out with an umbrella, and he like twiddles the umbrella around like a Mary Poppins skit. Like it's amazing.
Yeah.
And like, this all needs this all the time. Like,
yeah, I know, man. They need to, I feel like they need to integrate the 205 Live people more into like the backstage segments. Just to, you know, solidify them really. Cause like, you don't see them beyond a match or two in Raw and then whatever you see on 205 Live. And I've yet to see an episode of 205 Live, but like, the crowd's not into it, and because they don't know them, and
because it's not a smart way to do.
And it's a bummer.
It's not a smart way to do business because they're filming 205 Live in the same arena after they film SmackDown.
Yeah.
So like,
yeah,
they already saw their big superstars that they bought the T-shirts and you know all this other stuff. Now stick around for another hour of the guys you maybe have never heard of. Like, that's a hard sell. You know, if anything, I think they should film 205 Live before SmackDown. Simply to use them as kind of the warm up, you know, kind of the opening act. Get people pumped and ready to see more wrestling, and yeah, use it like kind of when you go to a concert, like, oh, I'm gonna see Ozzy Osbourne, but before that, like Rob Zombie's coming out or something, you know.
Yeah,
like you're just like gonna work the crowd up a little and get them going. You're the opening act, and I think
I will say that on Raw, Akira Tozawa had his Raw debut.
Oh yeah,
and he out of everybody that I've seen, he got a good pop.
Good,
because I believe what he was doing in the Cruiserweight tournament, like Akira Tozawa would like just scream out like right?
Yeah.
And then like on the tournament, like the crowd was like was doing it, but Akira was like, no, shh, quiet, you know, like I'm trying to focus type of thing.
Yeah.
But when he was doing it on Raw, and he, you know, he's doing the same thing, the crowd was getting into it, right? But like he let the crowd get into it, so he didn't try to shush them or anything.
Gotcha.
Like, you got something like that.
He's a smart guy, man.
It's something he did that. Yeah.
His stuff in Dragon Gate was very good because that's what he would do. Out of that whole crew, I think he had the best crowd charisma. Like he could tell kind of the pulse of what was going on, and someone else who's just a master of that is Tajiri. And it was nice that those two were kind of a thing in 205 Live, you know, like, I'm going to take Akira Tozawa under my belt a little bit and teach him the old ways and all this stuff. There was a little bit of that, and then they kind of spread them out, rightfully so. But yeah, just 205 Live is a weird, like, I don't know how I feel about it.
It's like they're still developing, but at the same time, like they're still developing, but at the same time, the crowd is not latching onto them as like what everybody would think. yeah. at the same time. Because, but there's something there. There's like there's a gem there though.
Yeah,
that needs to be like, you know, buffed.
Yeah, I think so, and I think it's just the nature of they're doing this weird thing where they want to keep storylines contained on 205 Live, and then they want to sprinkle a little bit of those into like a Raw or a SmackDown or something. Like, oh, did you see what happened on 205 Live? It's like,
yeah.
How invested were you ever in like Saturday night main event or whatever? Like,
yeah, I'm actually surprised they don't put those like the cruiserweight matches on like the main event. And what's the other one?
Like,
what's the other show?
Whenever they would do Heat, Sunday Night Heat.
Yeah. I mean, like the other show that they have right now, Superstars, I think. Yeah.
Oh,
Superstars.
Yeah.
Yeah, they should put like some of the matches there too, and then maybe yeah. I mean, I know they do NXT stuff too, and just put them all over the place, just where they can you're able to see like a cruiserweight something.
Yeah, and
just you so that you have them out there.
And they signed on how many guys? 18, 19 guys.
Yeah.
Use them. Yeah. Like sprinkle them out there, like kind of fill in the gaps, and that way you're not just you don't have to have Seth Rollins at every other bit. You know what I mean? Yeah. Like
you don't have to use Neville all over the place.
Bingo. Yeah. It's like we can.
Even see though he's the champ now.
Yeah, that's true. And I mean, it's just interesting. They have so many superstars, but they're afraid to use any of them. It seems, you know, they just don't want to. I don't know. It seems like they're waiting to pull the trigger on it.
It's a give and take because, we're saying like it's developing, but then again, the people are not latching on. But at the same time, they need to have room to develop. So if you don't give them that, then like how are they going to develop otherwise, right?
Bingo. Right. Yeah. Exactly. You know, and they need to
winning the crowd and all that stuff.
They need to mix a little bit with the main roster, just enough, like. Just enough for Roman Reigns to give, you know, Cedric Alexander the stink eye or something.
Yeah.
And then just back off of it for a while. But then whenever you want to call Cedric up out of 205 Live, he already has a predisposition to, you remember Roman Reigns when you looked at me cross? Well, now we're going to fight. Like, that's all your storyline you need. You don't need some big dramatic thing. It's, I tried to come on Raw and I was very excited and then you treated me like crap. Well, I'll show you, you know, that's all it is. That's all you need.
So they were doing that. They do a little bit of that when it was Sami Zayn and Cesaro when they had their best of whatever kind of matches.
Yeah.
And then their final match was like the first NXT pay-per-view. And then they did another one another thing like that when it was, Bo Dallas, when he was a straight face, like a straight baby face, and like he was doing something with Wade Barrett. And then there was a thing with Wade Barrett and Bo Dallas, like Bo Dallas had his Wade Barrett's number and he just kept beating him or eliminating him in like Royal Rumble. And it gave Bo Dallas a good rub at that point in time. So like you could definitely do that with main roster and getting and putting these cruiserweight guys into like the main roster in the main show.
And I mean the talent's there, man.
Yeah, man.
I mean Neville is $1 million. That dude is money. Like
King of the Cruiserweights, the barbaric.
Yes,
like he's got going.
The heel run that he's having right now is that it reminds me of Mark Henry's House of Pain.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Like it's that sort of like you're not going to stop this monster. And they need to just make him go on a tear for like 5 months of just kind of. But it's funny because they're doing something like that with Asuka in NXT for the women.
Right.
And then people are starting to complain, oh, Asuka's just unbeatable. I'm like, of course she is right now.
Yeah.
Until they bring in the one person that beats Asuka and they're instantly made a superstar. Like that's how it works. That's how it always works. That's why Brock Lesnar. Yeah. Keeps getting his ass kicked by Goldberg. Like you built up Brock Lesnar as this
believable.
Yeah. Is this unbelievable machine that doesn't give a fuck. And he hard weighs Randy Orton in the forehead and he does all this stuff. And then Goldberg comes and squashes him And you're like, mm-hmm. whoa. Like, I think the whole build for Brock Lesnar over the past, what, 2 or 3 years was actually the build for Goldberg, right? Because they're building up Lesnar as this unstoppable monster that doesn't give a shit. And he, you know, tells Heath Slater he doesn't give a damn about his kids. Like, just someone has to stop this guy. He's a monster. And, like, people were legit upset. They were, like, they had real heat on him. They thought he's not safe. He failed the UFC drug policy. This guy's a cheater. Get him out of there. He's trying to hurt people. Like, people bought in hook, line, and sinker to the Brock Lesnar.
So
then Goldberg comes in and squashes him. Guess what? Now Goldberg is, once again, the man. Like, that's all it takes. It's a genius booking, but it's very rare for it to happen because it's not every day you get a Brock Lesnar. It's not every day you get an Oscar.
Yeah.
You know.
And you can't just pick anybody from, like, say, the roster. Like, it needs to be, like, say, like, the Goldberg. You need to find somebody, not like Goldberg, but, like, how am I trying to go with this? Like, I mean, I use Goldberg as, like, the example because, like I said, it's believable when I see Goldberg beating Lesnar.
Yes.
Since Lesnar seems to be unbeatable. If you put him, if you put like Lesnar against like KO, sure I guess I can see that, but but at this point right now I don't believe it.
Yes,
right?
It's a suspension of disbelief. Yeah, I know where you're going with that. So that's that kind of goes back to Brock Lesnar versus The Undertaker, whenever Brock broke the streak. People were like, I can't believe they did that. I can't believe they did that. But then you and I talked, you know, and we both kind of agreed. We were like
it's
who else?
Possible.
Who else?
Yeah.
Like, of course Brock Lesnar destroyed the 70-year-old man. Like, if you look at it, not even kayfabe, you don't even look at the wrestling storyline side of it. It's like in a fight versus the 65-year-old man and the fucking two-time heavyweight UFC champ, who's going to win?
UFC champ
every time. So it makes sense. And like Goldberg coming back is bigger than Brock Lesnar, physically a bigger human being. So it makes total sense. If someone's going to whoop Brock's ass, it's going to be the bigger guy. Like, it's just the way it is.
So now here we are on Fastlane. I think that's what the Raw one is.
I think
Goldberg versus KO. Do you think Goldberg will win the belt? My initial feeling was, I don't think he's going to win the belt. But now I think about it now, I'm like, you know what? Where they're going with Goldberg right now, I feel like it's possible.
It's possible.
Because now when you go down to WrestleMania, then, you know, Lesnar can take it from Goldberg.
Yeah. And maybe, but I actually think, I don't think Goldberg's going to win simply because I think KO is going to pull shenanigans. Like,
That's
you know
true.
What I mean? That's KO's whole thing. It's like, if he wants to be the conniving, smarky, sort of like, haha, I outfooled you. Like
the heel champion, basically.
Exactly. Yeah, a heel champion. The dude, the dirtiest player in the game. Shit. Like, he's gonna take off the turnbuckle pad. He's gonna do the crotch chops. He's gonna do like the the eye pokes and the stuff you're not supposed to do. Like, I think
Kevin's gonna reminding me of
do what?
Ben. I just like you're saying this, like, he's reminding me of Toru Yano now. He's reminding me of Toru Yano.
Right.
The thievery and
that's what it is, man. Like, so I think Goldberg, but then what that's gonna do is it's gonna fuel Goldberg and he's gonna be pissed and he's gonna go and kick a door off the hinges, and then he gets more upset, and then he's gonna take it out on Brock Lesnar. Like, I think there's gonna be a catalyst.
Oh, okay.
Or Lesnar's gonna cost him the belt. I mean, there's going to be something. So I think it's smart to keep the belt on Kevin, but I also think it's very smart to use him as a heel to get more heat and more kind of people excited about Goldberg versus Lesnar. I think, because that, I mean, Goldberg's still not in, I mean, you could argue he was never in ring shape, He's had good matches. He's had, in fact, mm-hmm. I think he has great matches. Goldberg in his prime, like versus Sting, versus DDP. Mm-hmm. Some bona fide, solid, like 3.75 to 4-star matches. Like, good wrestling matches. He's had them. I don't think he can anymore. I mean, I could be proven wrong, but I don't. Mm-hmm. I think bringing Goldberg out, I think the squash was beautiful. It was a perfect way to make him not get winded, to show mm-hmm. that he looked like $1 million. They were in and out of there in 2 minutes and 15 seconds. And then the Royal Rumble, of course, it's genius because he's not holding up the match. Like, it's 30 people.
So right. he just has a spot, take him out.
Exactly. You take out two or three people and then someone takes you out and you look frustrated and then you're done. You still look like a monster. Yeah. You're good to go.
Yeah.
So I'm almost kind of worried that their match is going to be not a repeat of WrestleMania 20, because those two guys were just, mm-hmm. they were checked out. Like, they didn't want to be there. They just getting the paycheck. Yeah. This time I think they want to at least put on an entertaining show, but yeah, we'll see. I just don't know if Goldberg can still go. Brock Lesnar can for sure. Brock Lesnar, I think, could carry Goldberg to a great match. Mm-hmm. But we'll see. I mean,
yeah,
it's a weird thing, but yeah, you know, that Goldberg mark, I think it's time to go to a little message from our sponsors. You know, I think we can do some of that. So, guys, we'll be right back. We're going to do a little mid-thing break. We haven't done one of these before ever. So here at Episode 18, we're making some history, right? But we will be right back after a word from our sponsors.
Woo!
So, Marco, you know what my favorite hobby is?
What's that?
I really like reading. Wait, no. You know what my second favorite hobby. You know what my first favorite hobby is?
What is that?
Listening to people tell me things.
Tell you stories.
I like a good story.
I do too. I love to hear a good story.
I wonder, is there a way somehow through technology to get people to read stories to us?
That you can hear the story and not have to look at words. Is that what you're trying to say?
Right, yeah. So what if you could take the reading out of reading? You know? Well,
where can you do that sort of thing?
Rumor is there's a website, audible.com, Amazon company, our good friends over there, best buds over there at amazon.com. At audibletrial.com/brothering around, it looks like... you get a free audiobook and a 30-day free trial.
Free?
Free. It says
$3.99.
$3.99. That's the price. All right. $3.99. You go there, you could choose over 180,000 of these things.
Unbelievable. Wow. 180,000? That's crazy. That's nuts.
That is more than like the amount of Hot Pockets I can eat. That's more that's more than like the matchsticks that come in the box. Like, there's a lot of matchsticks in that box. I don't think it's 180,000.
Yeah, that's true.
I mean, 180,000 is a lot. But yeah, over at audibletrial.com/brothering around, you get the free book. You get the 30-day free trial. They read to you, man. If you got a device that can listen to Brothering Around, you got a device that can listen to your audiobook, and it's yours to keep forever. And they said here to say that it's from their boys at Brothering Around. So I think we just cracked this case, my friend.
I think we cracked the case. Sherlock Holmes.
Oh, man. Watson. We got to go over the Sherlock Holmes books now. We got to get our books. Got to get it. Audibletrial.com/brothering around. Go get it for free. Keep it forever from your boys here at Brothering Around. Oh, we're back from break. So, the Goldberg thing is just interesting to me because there's a lot happening with that.
It's interesting, yeah, because initially, it was just supposed to be maybe the one match, like their first match, and then maybe that was that.
Yeah.
Then you come to find out they're going to extend all the way up to WrestleMania. So, kudos on, Brock Lesnar seeing, you can make money here. Because Goldberg is, he's the piece where general, casual fans are still, super fans of Goldberg.
Yeah.
When the whole thing about Goldberg beating Lesnar came around, everybody was, marking out to that.
Yes.
Not just hardcore wrestling fans, but everybody from ESPN and just all the fans of the Attitude Era, they grew older and stopped watching wrestling. They hear this and what? Bill Goldberg? Well, okay, I gotta see this.
Yep.
So yeah.
And it brings up an interesting deal because with the things like NXT, I mean the wrestling business itself, the way that what fans mm-hmm. want and. You know, hardcore marks or smart marks or whatever you want to call them, and the business is it's staying the same. It's all a work still, but the the focuses are different. Yeah. And I think there's still that weird thing about, oh boy, they're bringing back Goldberg and Brock Lesnar, two part timers that are getting a spot at WrestleMania. But I've never thought that way. Anytime I hear a regular wrestler, just a full-timer going on the road, saying, oh, well, how dare they bring in these part-timers? I'm like, two things, man. One, don't be a mark. Number two, don't be a mark. If you're caring about that spot more than the company making money, come on, man. This whole thing is to make money.
And they still draw. So
bingo. Captain Lou Albano. Lou back in the day said there are two things real about the wrestling business. The money and the miles. That's it. That's it. Money and the miles.
Yeah.
Everything else is a fucking work. So if you're getting butthurt that Bill Goldberg's drawing more money than you and bringing new eyes into the product, do something about it.
Yeah,
that's the way I feel about it, man.
Exactly.
I mean, what were you think you could have that same type of pop with Brock Lesnar? Really, you think you could? I don't think so. I think you know what I mean. I think it's smart to bring Goldberg back. I think it's smart to hype up this Undertaker match as maybe his last one. I think it's smart to. Do these things hell, Undertaker literally wrestles twice a year.
Yeah.
But nobody calls him out on being a part-timer.
Exactly.
So is it where's just
that? Yeah. Where's everybody there?
I mean, cause as he's paid his dues maybe, but fuck. So did Goldberg shit. Goldberg held up WCW almost single-handedly. You had the outsiders. They came in. You had the whole Kevin Nash, Scott Hall, NWO, that whole thing built up a lot of deal. But the thing is, whenever you build a monster like heel faction, like the NWO, you need an even bigger baby face to just rip through.
Yeah.
And that was Goldberg. Goldberg was the only guy. They had DDP for a little bit, but it almost felt like DDP was more of the, once again, the dirty player. Trying to get in, they would say, oh, we're going to convert DDP to the NWO. He never quite joined. So he was always kind of the rough rider. He was the guy on the outside. And of course, you had Sting. You had Sting who came back as the Crow, which is still the best gimmick I've ever seen. But then you had Goldberg, and Goldberg just didn't care. He was an uncaged animal. And set him loose on something. Just the way he was booked was perfect. Him coming out with all the security guards. And it's funny because I remember in an interview, I think it was Arn Anderson. I think it was Pat Patterson and Arn Anderson were discussing Goldberg's gimmick, while it was still becoming a thing. And then one of them, I think it was Arn Anderson was like, it does not make sense that he has that many security guards around him. That's the biggest dude in the building. Like, why is he surrounded by security guards? Like, he can handle himself. And then Pat Patterson's like, no, man, those security guards are there as like a bear tamer. Like, they're there to make sure Goldberg doesn't eat children on the way to the, you know what I mean? Like, that's what this gimmick is like, here's that's an animal opponent. And we have handguns next to us in case he gets crazy. Like, so awesome. That whole thing is rad. Like, no one else like, could pull that off.
Like that whole, that 2K, was it 2K17?
Yes.
Commercial? Yeah. When they unveiled that Goldberg was going to be the...
Great.
That was commercial. A DLC. They had to break open a safe, like, in like in the mountains to get him out. Or, like, you know, to say, knock, knock, hey, we need you now, Goldberg. Use, like, explosions just to open the door. That's... One and sheriffs.
Speaking of, man, I actually got 2K17.
It, oh, did you?
It
okay.
It came out yesterday on PC, and of course, I was at my conference. So I'm gonna install it. I'm gonna install it tonight. And it's like 50 gigs. The game's huge.
Oh wow.
But it comes with I think all the DLC, all the extra characters and stuff. So the thing is. What I'm going to do is I'm going to make you and I, and then okay. I'm going to give us the tag team entrance that the Good Brothers do. So
there you go.
They're, you know, cause they're in the game now, all that stuff. They're officially in there as part of like a DLC pack. I'm going to give us the Good Brother intro and we're going to do some work. I might do I'm trying to think if I want to do just random, I know an episode of Comilog will be I actually have a 2K16 match recorded already that I could speak over. But I'm thinking if I could do just have that in the background during the episodes of Comedy Log, like matches of you and I versus, you know, whoever, a New Day or it'd be great. It'd be funny.
Yeah, you work on the commentary, color commentary, man.
Oh yeah, I just have to call it like as the computer's playing it. I call the live. Match, man. Oh my god, that'd be a train wreck. It'd be hilarious.
And see how really difficult it is. Yeah, there you go.
Like my neck snaps and extends across the arena, and it's like, oh my god. What
you're forgetting moves names. Like why am I forgetting moves names? Yeah, now? Why do I not remember what a clothesline is?
Right. I'm like, oh, the lariat.
The long arm. Hook punch.
The long arm face downy is the powerful. Oh no, he's picking him up really for powerful. The overhead extendo slam. It's like people are like, what the fuck is this guy talking about? Man.
Yeah.
Like, I'll just say Michael Cole's job is not easy. People give him grief. A job, you know, but of course, then you have Morrow. Who makes it look like the most simple thing. He's like, oh, the Blue Tiger Bomb, also known as the, and you're like, oh my God, the Falcon Arrow, originally made by so-and-so in All Japan Pro Wrestling. And you're like, oh man, that dude's an encyclopedia.
Yep. I'm surprised he didn't get in trouble for referencing Hiroki Goto.
I know it, man. I was like, oh, that's New Japan stuff. It's funny because Dave Meltzer is starting to people are so worried like why isn't Shinsuke being called up, why isn't so and so being called up to the main roster. That's another kind of pet peeve of mine, and I'll get to this. I was actually talking with a guy on a forum about this, and everyone was so upset that Ty Dillinger was not actually called up to Raw. They were like, why wasn't he called up? That guy's 36 years old. You know, time's a ticking. Like, he's getting up there in age. He needs to get on the main roster and get his full thing. They want all this to happen in, like, 4 months. They want him to get onto Raw. They want him to win every belt on the company. They want him to be the next Daniel Bryan. They want all this other stuff. And I'm like, here's the thing, man. Ric Flair still takes bumps. And that dude's 109 years old. Like, you're in a business to where 36 is a spring chicken. You got plenty of time. Like, he can take his time. He works a safe style. He doesn't do the crazy over-the-top, like, tope suicida shit. Like,
mm-hmm.
he just does good European uppercuts. He does great looking drop kicks. He's solid. He does some overhead suplexes. The guy's good. He works. Basically, he is a more mat based version of Cesaro, like Ty Dillinger style. Mm-hmm. Yeah, okay. In my opinion.
Yeah.
So it's more based on he could work like that till he's 55. Like, mm-hmm. You know, God forbid something happens and a shoulder blows out or something. But like,
yeah,
it's not, he's not on his deathbed. Like, he doesn't, I don't know what this thing is of people need to be called up right away and people need to.
Yeah. So like the business of wrestling. Yeah. You can do it at that age, like older. Right.
Yeah.
Where in areas like where the thing that I used to do called tricking, martial arts tricking.
Right.
Dude, old age is like old age is basically considered like 30.
Sure.
Because your knees can't take that kind of pressure.
Right.
On landing on one leg all the time. Right. And I was feeling it in my 20s, like 25.
Sure.
I was starting to feel it on my knees. In wrestling, you can do it. People are still doing it, like at old age, right? Yeah. Undertaker, for example.
Yeah, man.
Sting, you know, Hogan, if they wanted to, yeah, they can still do it at that old age. Like, you just do the greatest hits, and like people will just love you for it, right?
Yeah, exactly. And of course, Taker's gonna get that hip replacement as soon as possible, mm-hmm. like. I mean, it has wear and tear on the body. Like, Mick Foley still can't walk straight, you know, yeah. But he could take a side power slam. He could, mm-hmm. he could do the Mr. Socko. He could sell t-shirts. And that's what it is you're selling merch. Like, yeah. This whole work, the whole crazy world of professional wrestling is to sell product. It's not even to necessarily sell, like tickets to the live events, like you hope they do and you hope they're packed and it's rowdy and, you know, everyone wants to be there. That way everyone else wants to be there, so they want to buy a ticket, and it's this mm-hmm. constant thing. But like, even that old documentary Beyond the Mat, someone asked Vince McMahon, like, what business is professional wrestling? And he says verbatim, I am in the movie business.
Mm.
Like, he makes DVDs. Mm. He makes pay-per-views. He makes, you know what I mean? Yeah. Like, that's the way he sees it, is I'm building movie characters, so then you buy the DVD of the pay-per-view. Or now you subscribe to the network, so you can see the movie every week. Like, that's how he makes his decisions. So then that makes more sense why he would bring back Goldberg. Why he would have Taker do whatever, why he would, you know, why The Rock.
He would push, like, Cena and Reigns.
Yeah, exactly. Like, you're building superheroes, man. Like, you're building his own version of the Marvel Universe, essentially. Mm-hmm. You know, and like, and then people are upset. I can't believe they're bringing The Rock back. Duh.
Yeah,
that dude's a fucking quadrillionaire. Like, of course you want the. He's the biggest movie star on planet Earth. Of course you want him on your product.
Yeah.
It makes sense.
Possibly be the president of the United States someday.
Yeah, right. Hey, nowadays it could be. 2018, man. Go vote for Dwayne Johnson.
Yeah. Either that or Kanye West.
Yeah, 2020. Either one. It'd all be about the same amount of effective, but yeah, like just right. Dress us anyone else, anybody else, please. But it's there's this weird conflict, and I guess what it reminds me of is like whenever musicians, mm-hmm. whenever they get signed on to a label, and then everyone's like, "Oh, you sold out. You sold out." And it's like, dude, bitches gotta eat, man.
Like,
gotta
take care of the family.
Feed my family. I got a house. Mm-hmm. Like, these things. Try turning in exposure. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. Like, do it for exposure and do it for the love of the art. Go see how many hot dogs the love of the art can buy you. Not very many.
Right. Yeah.
Not very many. Mm-hmm. And it may sound cynical or whatever, but like, of course they love it. That's why they do it. There are way better ways and way less stressful on your body ways to make money than professional wrestling. Trust me. Mm-hmm. Like, you know,
it kind of goes back to the whole Twitch thing.
Yeah.
It kind of goes back to it. Like we were talking about before, you know, doing it for the love of it, won't. And if it's your only income, it is not going to help you out unless you do make it your only thing.
Yeah.
And you somehow get like a rub of money and stuff like that, that and popularity, right?
Yeah.
So.
Yeah. It's, and I mean, and it's a slippery slope because then, of course, you don't want it to all be about the money.
Mm-hmm.
But at a certain point, it almost has to be. And you have to, like, you have to see what your left hand is doing and what your right hand is doing. And are they going for the same mm-hmm. goal? Like, and I wonder if it comes with age. Because I used to be very much the hippie style. Like, do it for the love and damn the man. Mm-hmm. You don't need money to be happy. And, like, but yeah. then once you get a little older and you start seeing how the world actually is. And you start having.
I got to pay for the couch.
Yeah, yeah, and like these experiences, and like, man, yeah. I got a kid. Like, you know, we're mm-hmm. getting married, and you start thinking like this, and you're like, how? Yeah. What? How can I secure my family, myself? It's nice to have these passion projects, and it's nice to have this, but like, genuinely, mm-hmm. the reason why we do Brethren Around. It's because this is the one outlet. This is this is one of our stress reliefs. So like this is a way mm-hmm. for us to get through the week. And we went to the gym and, you know, Marco did kickboxing and, you know, he's doing Muay Thai stuff. And like, but after that, you just need to unwind for a second.
Mm-hmm.
And like, since we've done podcasts and entertainment before, it's like, let's just record it. Like, what's the worst that's going to happen? Like, just fucking put it out there. Someone might listen. Someone might like it. And I think those type of ideas, and it goes back to that conference I was at and stuff, the ideas that come from a genuine place, like, let's just do the thing. Let's just do it.
Mm-hmm.
It's not necessarily because we have an innate love and, well, podcasting is my life's work and my calling.
Yeah. Like
no. Like, who says that? No one.
Yeah, I think I'm personally at a stage or like, or my outlook is like, I don't want, say, like, my YouTube channel be the only thing I do.
Yeah.
Beyond, like other than, like me working at a job. Like, I don't want that to be the only thing I do, right? Because I'll be consumed by doing it. Like, I'll need to have, like, an influx of content every single day or something like that. Like,
right.
You'll worry about stuff like that, right? Yes.
Yeah.
So, if you put it as a side thing and you work your other job, that feels more... I feel much better about it because, like, I can, you know, say pump content like whenever I can. I'm not stressed about, oh, how the numbers look. Like, you know, did I put out a video today?
Yeah.
Or like, how, you know, how does the views look? Well, you know, what does my subscriber count look like? Because when you hear people say like, you know, do the thing that you love to do, or you know, like, it doesn't feel like a job if it's something you love to do. Like, I could see that, sure. But my personal standpoint is I don't want the thing that I love be tainted, but well, like,
yeah, become the job,
lessen the value of it.
Yeah.
Really.
Yeah. And that totally makes sense. And there's another saying that's kind of on that same point is like, you know, do what you love. How does it go? Like, you know, whenever you're in college, major in whatever it is you love. If you do what you love, you never work a day in your life.
Right.
They say that, but the added end part of that is, you know, do what you love and you'll never work a day in your life. That's true because that's not hiring right now.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Yeah. Like, sure, be a movie director. Make your movies.
That's a harsh thing to get into, you know.
You gotta know. Yeah. You gotta be aware. Like, it's not just a leap of faith, but it is an actual leap off the Grand Canyon. Mm-hmm. Like, and I'm not, and we're not saying
basket type of thing. And
I know it's probably easy for some people to be listening right now and thinking it's getting twisted about, well, I shouldn't pursue what I like to do. That's not what we're saying whatsoever, because we're still on the side burner, like pursuing everything. We have a lot of stuff going on.
Yeah, the thing that we do, like, I could just talk about me. Like, for me, I personally like the thing that I like to do on the side rather than it be the only thing I do. That's what I'm trying to say. For me.
Sure. Because it keeps it fun.
Yeah.
It keeps it as a stress relief. It keeps it as, here's the thing I get to relax, and finally I get my me time where I get to record my video and post it up on YouTube. And, you know, then if I get some comments, great. That means some people watched it. And you know what? I'll try harder on my next one, and maybe more people will watch it. But it never becomes this. You never make the agenda. You never make an itinerary. It's not a, well, it's 9 a.m. on Tuesday. You know what that means. That means I have to record my dialogue for the video that goes up on Wednesday. Like, no. And I mean, if you're trying to pursue it as your career, absolutely do it that way. 100% keep your schedule, wake up, crack you know, freaking dawn, get it going, like make those connections and network and work hard and put all your stuff into it. But if you want to keep it fun, do it part-time, do it when you can, do it on the side. Don't stress yourself out so much that you end up corrupting the thing that you love so much.
And it
ties into everything. At a certain, like, I will never forget the Metallica quote, whenever they made, the Black Album, they made that album. It had Enter Sandman. It had all these songs. It's kind of their greatest hits now. So they would get, rock and roll fans, old school rock and roll fans. Oh, screw Metallica. You guys sold out. You guys sold out. And then they're like, yeah, we sell out every night.
Yeah.
You can't buy tickets, bro. Like, we're sold out legit. Like, that's it, man. They made it the business, and now, but it's their job. You ask them what they do in their spare time, it's not making music. Guarantee you, it's not making music. You know?
Fun time would be like, who's the lead guitar? Like, Lars?
Kirk Hammett is the lead guitar, and then
or like who's the one that like went did drums on like a concert or something? I mean that's what I was thinking about, because I think Chris Jericho talked about it on one of the podcasts. Some guy from Metallica just went to this other concert and he did drums, and like he had a great time.
Yeah,
that sounds like the thing that he doesn't do when he's just doing guitaring.
Yeah, for his job, right? It's still related to his field, but now he's doing something different. You see that all the time with, like, you'll see guys that work in, like, animation studios. You know, they'll work for Sabin, or, you know, they'll work for all these different companies, but then in their spare time, they'll paint. They'll do something related that helps their skill set at work, but it's a way to unwind that's different enough that, like, it's almost like never the two shall meet. Like, I'm going to learn some stuff in my hobby that will help me at my job, but I'm not going to cross the streams. Like, I'm going to keep things separate. And I think that's a healthy way to look at it. It's like, it can't be your all, because you're going to burn out. If it's everything that your life revolves around, you're going to end up hating it.
Yeah.
Hating it. And it ties back. We started about with the part-time pro wrestler thing. If Goldberg wants to come back to have one last hurrah because it's fun, why not?
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Like, sure, he paid his dues already. He doesn't have to be a fucking full-time wrestler. Like, no. He held up a company single-handedly. Like, he's kind of earned his spot to come back whenever the hell he wants to. This whole, like, starving artist mentality that the world has, like, art's only good or creative things are only good is if the people that are making it have to suffer and starve, and like, fuck all that. Like, that's a very misguided idea.
I need to get. I need to pay my bills, man.
Yeah, it's like, come on, bro. This car just doesn't. It doesn't run on hopes and dreams. Like this, I need fucking gas for my car.
Right. You know. Right.
So come on now.
And we're about to have like driverless cars now.
Apparently, hell, they have that Amazon. Our good friends at Amazon made that terrifying store to where you just walk in and grab stuff off the shelf and leave.
Oh, yeah, that's right.
It knows what you bought based on how much it weighs and like where you got it because the sensor is looking at you.
Yeah.
Yeah, but that's not terrifying at all. But hello, Amazon. Hi. Don't pull our sponsorship. Thanks. We love it. We love the idea. Keep it up.
And driverless cars.
Yeah, just to have them all the time. Yeah, I'll just take a driverless car to
Can you imagine? Like we were watching that in movies, right?
Yeah.
Like, you know, futuristic movies where the character and like say like their girlfriend or wife or boyfriend, whatever, they're in the car and they're talking and the car is driving itself.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
And we would think, oh man, that's so far in the future, and like we're not going to see that. We're literally seeing that like right happening in our eyes. Like
we're on the cusp.
Is this really going to be a thing?
We're on the cusp. I'm trying to figure out.
And floating cars too. Like what the hell?
Yeah, I'm trying to figure out because we are the last generation that can literally tell stories of what life was like before the internet.
Yeah. Right.
What's going to be the thing? What's going to be the internet 50 years from now? What's going to be that one huge revelation that changes everything about all of the world forever? And then
it's going to be Google contacts. Like eye contacts. You're going to browse the internet in your eye.
Probably so, man. Or like
probably so, right?
Like a fully like a camera that's installed in your brain that like you take pictures of exactly what you're seeing like in perfect clarity and then it sends it off to your unlimited hard drive so then your hard drive can tie into your brain as well, so at any point if you wanted to return back to like we went to Guam or we went somewhere like that, you could just shut your eyes for a second and then go through your brain hard drive and get a perfect clarity experience of where, like, yeah. That's it, man.
And you can upload your brave wavelength into something, and then when you die...
That's right. You're not really... You're just
They turn that thing on, and you basically live forever.
It's like Sword Art Online.
this is what it all ties down
That's
to.
That's it. They predicted the future. Dot hack is real, everyone.
Dot hack, right? Dot like hack, we're all going to be stuck in the RPG and
crazy.
You have to figure out how to live life in RPG. And
that's right. We're
gonna, are we going to actually try to leave, or we'll are you just going to live life?
We'll team up and we'll cook boar meat. Like boar we'll go meat. Kill all the level 2 boars and just eat them.
Yeah,
that's all we'll do, man. We'll have some big ass swords that don't make any sense. Like, why do we have swords that are 19 feet tall? But we do.
You reminded me of what I watched like these past weeks with Maggie.
Yeah, yeah.
So, like I said before, I was watching Maggie. Mm-hmm. I think it's pronounced Maggie. Adventures of Sinbad. So I watched the actual first season, Labyrinth of Magic, and I finished today.
Oh wow!
Kingdom of Magic, and there's one character that literally has too big of a sword when he announces or when he conjures it up, because they have a thing of like, calling out your weapon's name or something, and then like it becomes like it's magical form. So like this guy like calls out his weapon's name, and then it's not like Bleach or anything, but it's literally a sword bigger than him, and like let's see how far, like miles length, and it's literally bigger than any like giant and all that stuff. But like he's swinging it, but when he swings it, he knows it's too heavy, but he tries to lift it anyway, but then he's there, he's swinging it down, and it's literally too big for him. It's literally too big of a sword.
Oh, that's amazing.
Yeah. Yeah, you know what? I would actually recommend you go watch that too.
It's good.
I liked it. It's like there's a lot of layers to it. Like there's magical forms. There's kingdoms. I was getting like a Suikoden vibe to it.
Oh yeah.
But then again, I was getting. And I'm not too familiar with the story, but like a romancing of the three kingdoms type of thing. Sure.
Right.
But then again, like I said, I'm not familiar with the story, but like there's three kingdoms that's in, kind of in a war, but like, yeah, it's good. I really liked it. Like I really want more. So like, and there's, yeah. Labyrinth of Magic is season one, Kingdom of Magic is season two, and then Adventures of Sinbad is like the side story thing.
Prequelish sort of thing. Interesting.
Yeah.
That's cool, man. I need to get back into the TV stuff. I really do. Now that I'm back away from the ostrich farms and all that stuff, I'll actually be able to watch television as part of civilized society once again.
And then Iron Fist, the Iron Fist trailer just debuted. I was like, oh man, it looks really cool.
Yeah, I need to
check. And I need to watch all the Marvel stuff. So
I need to start reading Spider-Man again.
I gotta hear your reaction to some things.
Just waiting.
Yeah.
Then I got Thor, God of Thunder to read through. I started that. I'm like four pages in, but I need.
Did you start it?
Yeah, and it's kind of in the prologue of
where Thor is at that point.
Yeah. So basically, Thor has been alerted that now gods are dying. And
that's right, God Killer. Yeah.
Yeah, and he's got.
The God Butcher.
Yeah, he's going to exactly the God Butcher and stuff. So he's going to like get just more evidence. See, like, does this remind me of anything? Like, have I seen this before?
It's weird that story, like Thor is becoming a detective.
Yeah, which I can get behind.
That's the thing I'm feeling from what I'm hearing about that story.
Which I could totally get behind Thor being Sherlock Holmes. Like that's a really neat dynamic that I never thought would have ever existed. I'll get on it. But I think that might be it for episode number 18, right. Man.
Yeah, we were all over the place.
It's a good one though. We legit had no plan. We learned about the power of that at our conference, dude. No agendas.
Yeah,
it's powerful stuff, bro.
The spirit of no notes.
We literally have seen that come to fruition. Like this episode is proof that either if you have no plan, it's either going to be incredible or it's going to be the hottest garbage.
Right?
Oh.
You put the maximum amount of effort and then you get minimal return.
Absolute. You overpromise and underdeliver. That's with brothered around. That's our gift to you. Just know the hype will be real and it will always let you down. That's the guarantee, the seal of approval. good times. But yeah, man, we'll see everybody next week. Send in those questions. Send them in. Hashtag brothering.
I will see you guys in 3 weeks. But whatever Wes was thinking about doing, he will see you next week.
That's right.
But I will be tuning in somehow, somewhere, if I can find it in some internet signal.
There will be archives. But there's going to be the next 3 weeks. It's going to be fun. It's going to be a little wild, a little crazy.
Wild West.
Let's say, you know, it'll be lit for sure. But you know, don't the kids say that it was? Don't the kids say that the party was live? Don't they say? Isn't that a saying?
Is
that a saying?
Is it?
The party's live.
I know. Yeah, I know. Lit is a thing. Yeah. Hmm. But
we'll get Thor on the case. He'll try to break this.
There you go.
Really interesting code that we're building right now. I wonder why you keep saying live. That's interesting. I wonder if that means
anything. You know.
But that's it, guys. I'm CommieDelbo, twitter.com/CommieDelbo. That's Mr. Marco Flores, twitter.com/MarcoPolo177. Send us questions. Yes. Hashtag brethren around.
I'll send you questions while I'm away. Dude. I'm going to do that.
We'll flip the script. That's what it's gonna be.
I'm gonna look for that moose. I'm gonna look for that moose and take a picture and like, dude, I found
send it. I'll put it up on the show, like on the YouTube archive.
Yeah.
Oh man, so good. And then, but what I'll do when right before I read it, I'll like put on my reading glasses and this comes from a listener.
This comes from. Yeah.
Let's see. Yeah. Hashtag.
I found a moose in the Philippines.
This gentleman found a moose in the Philippines.
Oh man!
All right, guys, that's it. Well, Marco, be safe, my friend.
Thank you, sir.
We'll see you. We'll see you soon, bro. And you got to tell us all kinds of stories.
I will store up the memory drive, and
that's right. You'll shut your eyes. Google uploads.
Yeah.
Just you need to narrate a book about it, and we'll listen to it.
I do.
Audible.
That's good.
That's it, guys. Well, yeah, we will. We'll see Marco in 3 weeks, and everyone out there in listener land, you may see me next week.